Good morning, Connect Church. How is everyone? Guys are looking good, feeling great. Well, happy April. Happy April. I hope this is going to be a beautiful month for us because there is so many things will happen this month. But before I go into what's going to happen in April, how many of you happy with the March you had, with a month of March we had in this church? Wonderful things happen, and I can't help but think that there is mental shift that's happening in every one of us. And we see that at this point, we need to stretch ourselves for what God is about to do in our lives. What God is about to do in our lives. And before I go into my message, I just want to remind you again what Dan, by the way, I feel bad for Brother Dan, who went to heaven and didn't see what he expected to see. But let's talk about grace on Easter, right? So when you invite people, talk about grace, invite them. But we wanted you to do two things. We wanted you to pray and invite. Pray and invite. Not just invite, but pray and invite. And this morning, you can expect any things. You know why? I have completed half a marathon yesterday. So, and let me give a shout out to Helen and Lex Kozlov. They did not give up. We all ran it together. So, great job, guys. And Lex, he didn't even train and he ran it. So that's why I said expect anything. You want to tell me something about how tired you are? It's not going to work. You're going to talk to me how busy you are for training? Not going to fly. So expect anything today. Well, this morning I just want to talk about chosen to serve. And we're going to stay in Book of Acts until Easter. And it's not a long time. It's just today and next Sunday. We're going to stay in Book of Acts. And as I was reading the Book of Acts, thinking about it, you know, Holy Spirit did something in me that I think is timely and necessary for us now as a church. So today I will start from Scripture, from reading the Scripture, and it's found in Acts chapter 6. And you're going to love this story. And I just want you to know that you've been chosen to serve. You've been chosen to be a part of what God is doing in this world. I'm not only talking about Connect Church, which obviously you're part of this church, but God wants you to use for something bigger. He wants you to see a bigger picture. So this morning, let's just go ahead and read this scripture. Chapter 6, let's start with verse 1. In those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So let me just give you a little bit background story on this. I don't know, we all have different knowledge of the Bible, but pretty much here's what happened. Remember how Jesus spent 3.5 years on this earth. He spent it with his disciples, feeding them, providing for them. Pretty much there was no trouble. They even have a little internship serving people, healing and casting out demons. And he taught them well. Of course, they were taught by Jesus. But now Jesus left and first church, and they didn't have a big church conference to go to and learn how to do church. No, it was just disciples, first Christians, and now they're doing church. And what happens? Bible says they have everything the people brought into the church that belonged to them personally, but now they donated it to the church and say they were using as according to their needs. They were distributing whatever they had according to their needs. And what happened here, Hellenistic Jews, those are Jews who lived outside of Palestine. They spoke Greek for the most part. They did not speak Hebrew or Aramaic. They spoke Greek, and they adopted names and culture, Greek culture, but they were Jews. And what happened when the food was distributed, they thought that they did not get the same portion, that they did not get the same attention as Hebraic Jews. So, and here's what happens next. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, "It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers and sisters, Choose 7 men among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them, and they will give our and we will give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the word. This proposal pleased the whole group. They chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. Also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. So the word of God spread. And other translation says, then, this translation says, the number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. This is a great story. I'm sure you read this story many times, but I want to apply this story to our church, to our situation today. How does it work in our situation? Many of us, if you started a business, if you started a family, if whatever you're starting, and in our case, we started Connect Church, and when things start grow, when your numbers growing, you think it's going to be all good. But you know, growth does not sustain itself. And if you don't do structurally, you don't do changes necessary structurally, financially, organizationally, your growth will collapse. It will not sustain itself. And couples, you know, if you have one child to provide for, it's easier than to provide for 5 children, right? No amens. Amen. I think we have 4, and I know that, of course, there is, you know, giving down the line, the shoes, the jeans, and everything. So it's, in some ways, it's easier, but you know it's going to take more attention. You know it's going to take more of your time, more dedication, more finances to have things grow. So here in chapter 6 of Acts, we find the church started growing. And of course, this great explosion of growth and people are being saved and everything's good is happening. But also, on the other hand, the negative things start happening. And that's where I want to bring your attention, that numbers create needs. Number create needs. Like I said, if you had one child, now you have 2 children. You have more need, especially wait till they're going to start growing and you have teenagers. They eat a lot. We don't even have teenagers, but now they like certain food, and they like this, but they don't like that, and they eat a lot. So there is need growing. Numbers create needs. At the same time, needs create opportunities. Right here, we see apostles presented with this need. Now the complaint got to the apostles. And they're saying, what are we going to do with this need? And the Holy Spirit, and they come together and they decide, here is the solution. There is a need, but there is an opportunity for you. In this church, as we grow, there are more needs. There are more classrooms to fill with staff and volunteers, or we call you dream team members. There is more need in every area of this church, but it also presents opportunity for all of us to step up and become the solution in the need. Here is what happens, though. Opportunities come, but do not linger. Opportunities come, but they don't linger. They don't keep knocking on the door. You know how there is a saying, they couldn't recognize it and see it, even if it was knocking on their door. The problem with knocking on the door is that someone else will hear the knocking and they will accept the challenge. They will open the door and they will face the need straight in the face, and they will use that as opportunity. So opportunity creates, needs create opportunities. But opportunities they come, but they don't linger. Here's, I like this quote for Thomas Edison. He was a smart guy. I have 2 quotes from him today. Opportunity is missed by most people because it dressed in overalls and looks like work. Sometimes it looks scary. Of course, we don't have many overalls nowadays. We don't wear them, but pretty much, let's say it wears jeans. By the way, Nadia and I are twinning today. It was not planned out when we got in the vehicle that we're wearing exactly the same thing. I guess we have similar taste. We're doing it today. Let's take some pictures. Opportunity is missed by most people. Most people, not all people, because it looks like work. As a business owner, I know that at work and in business, you have opportunities that you are scared of because it presents itself as a lot of work. And you think, how can we get this accomplished? And I must admit to you that I like things steady and slow. Those of you who know me, I'm not easily confused or easily pulled to the side. I like things steady and slow. I have a course of things that should go, and I like schedule. For me, it's difficult to shift my attention, do something, and jump at the opportunity. So those of you who are like me, we understand each other. That sometimes you're so down into your groove that an opportunity was there next to you. You will miss it because you're focused on what you're doing. But opportunity, when it presents itself, you need to get hold of it. You need to be available for it. And especially if we are listening to the Holy Spirit. Let's lean in. Let's be open, especially today, as we, you know, approaching Easter. We're going to invite people. If we want to invite people, we have to prepare the place. And if we're going to have more people, there's going to be more need. And in other words, there's going to be more opportunity for us to step up and minister to them and serve them. Number two, all the called are chosen. I want to stay on this scripture today. When the apostles were presented with the need, there was a great need and there was a complaint. Did you know that every complaint is a result of unmet need? And if we just dismiss that and say, hey, people just like to complain, instead of going down to the source of the complaint and saying, why is this complaint exist? What can we do to serve people better to eliminate this complaint? And here is what the apostles did. They said, hey, guys, or they said brothers and sisters, not guys. And they said, choose where? Among you. All the called are chosen. When the opportunity presented itself as a result of a need, apostles said, choose among you. I'm a big believer that in the church of Jesus and in Connect Church, if there is a need, we're not going to look outside of the church for people who can serve and help us to do the ministry. I'd rather look inside among you, people who are committed, people who are here, people who love the church, who love God, to do the ministry and answer the need, answer the call. So apostle said, choose among you. And then all the chosen are called to be equipped. You know, as I was running yesterday, about, and I'm not going to spoil the whole experience. This has to be a separate message. I tell you, there's so much has to be a separate message. For me, the hardest was, and I haven't had a chance to talk to Lex and Helen, the hardest was mile 9 to 10. By the way, half a marathon, it's 13.2 miles. So it sounds big, but after half, it becomes easy. So those of you who are, you know, after 50, it should be easy. There's less pressure in life because you've got here. So you can do another half. And for me, it was hardest after mile nine, because in my mind, I thought the next mile marker I'm going to see going to be 11. And I was expecting to see 11. And when I got next mile marker, it was 10. It just got to me, and it was the first time I walked. I walked for about a minute because I thought, I know, thank you. Because I thought it's going to be Mark, mile 11, it's only 10. I don't know if I got it in me. And when I felt like my lungs are going to collapse and my legs is going to buckle, I got to the top of the hill. And you know, the cheerleaders there. I don't know. Those are nice people. Who called them there? Why are they there early in the morning? But there's a little girl. She stood there and said, I believe in you. You can do it. I never saw her in my life. So I thought about encouraging people. And there was a lot of cheerleaders and giving water and everything. They're like, you can do this. And so from then on, I didn't stop again. And I just ran on and finished that marathon. But let me tell you this. When you train for it, it could be very lonely. As you run the streets, and as we traveled to California, and I had some time in the morning, I was running those neighborhoods and run those streets, and you would feel very lonely and almost pointless training. You don't see anybody around you. You feel like you're alone. Like there is no one that is training for it. But you know what happened yesterday when I showed up there? Hundreds of people are there. They're training, or they've been training alone in their, maybe on their treadmill, maybe running the streets in the morning, maybe after work, whenever they train. But when we all came together, there is excitement, there is energy, there are results, and we ran for good cause for Camp Barnabas. It's for kids with disabilities, so they can go to that camp. We ran for great cause, but all these people were training in private, in secret. Here's what Paul says in 2 Timothy 3:17. He says about the word of God. He says about preparing yourself. And then he says, so that the men of God may be complete and proficient, outfitted and thoroughly equipped for what? To boast about his knowledge, to show off his muscles, to tell others that he's training for something. You know how many people today, they have the knowledge of the scripture, but all they do, they stand in the way of the ministry. All they do, they just boast about who they are and what they represent. But all pastor needs, all Jesus needs is their shoulder, not their knowledge. When it comes down to it, so Paul says, the word of God is good for teaching and rebuking, correcting, training, so that you will be equipped for every good work. He doesn't say, so you will be equipped to show off. He doesn't say, so you be equipped so you feel good about yourself. And when you appear before God, you can say, hey, I've read your scripture back and forth. He says, so that you will be ready for every good work. You have been chosen to serve in the kingdom of God, not to come to church. Which is good, that's equipping. But what's the purpose of equipping? What's the purpose of the message? What the purpose of worship, Sunday worship? So that you will be equipped to do the work of God outside of these walls. Make someone's lives better. Make someone's pain easier. Make a difference in this world. We've been chosen to serve. We've been chosen to change this world for Jesus Christ. Here is another quote from the same guy. He says, from Addison, he says, we should remember that good fortune often happens when opportunity meets with preparation. Remember I said when you're training, it's almost like pointless. And I was sharing with my friends that after 7 miles, you almost see there is no point. Your heart rate is steady. You have no pain. So you think you're ready to hit 13. I'm not ready to hit 26. But I felt like I was ready to hit 13 because there is no other motivation. But when preparation meets opportunity, that's when results happened. So Paul says, Timothy, as you train yourself in the knowledge of the Word of God, as you prepare yourself, it's for the purpose so that you may be ready for every good work. Connect Church, I just want to challenge every one of you to understand and to honestly acknowledge before God that the price Jesus paid for us is way too high for us to enjoy this life. Come and live comfortably. Come to church and claim our own seat. The price is too high. Jesus never told us to sweat about our salvation. When he came to this earth, he paid it in full, and he says it's finished. His work of salvation for us is finished, but our work creating a difference in this world just beginning. We are not done until we're dead. So if we are around, that means God has worked for us and we have been called and chosen to serve in this world to make the difference. Let's prepare ourselves. And when there is opportunity, let's step out and do it. And that leads me to point number three. We all have different tasks, but receive the same training. We receive the same training. If you come to a restaurant, and you know their food is good, but then you go to the bathroom and it's horrible, would you come back? Probably not, unless you go home, hold it in, go home. You don't want that. You don't want that. You want your experience from the greeters to your place, to your table, to food, to restroom, to waiters, to be the same, right? You want it to be the same. So here is what Apostle said. Hey, guys, it's not good for us to leave the Word of God, the preaching and teaching, and go wait on tables to give out food. But here is what they said. It just gets to me every time I read this. They said, but choose 7 men of what kind? Who maybe they occasionally drink. You know, they're not going to do anything important. They're just going to give out bread. They're just going to, you know, keep track of how many everyone received or whatever they received. You know, maybe they're okay if they, you know, they maybe slip once in a while. You know, it happens to everyone. What's the big deal? They're not going to do anything important. He says, make sure they're full of the Spirit of God, full of wisdom, and have good reputation. Because when it comes to the house of God, you're not the second. You're not the second class citizen if you don't stand up here. You know why? Because what you do out there on a parking lot, what you do taking care of kids, what you do preparing for the service, what you do give out gifts to the community, it's driven by the same Spirit. And God is more interested in you than in what you do. I will repeat this always, and I started saying this before we launched this church, that God is more interested in us than what we can do for Him. He saved us from eternal punishment so we can spend eternity with Him. He didn't send us here as secret agents to do the work of the kingdom of God. He sent us here to change the world by winning more people for Him, so then we can bring more people into His presence through the good news of salvation. That's why we're here. So even though we have different tasks, we have the same training. And the Apostle said, make sure they're full of the Holy Spirit. Make sure they're full of wisdom of God. Make sure they have good reputation. It's because no matter what they do, they represent the King. They represent Jesus. They represent the Heavenly Father. And no matter what you do, be ready to be transferred. Those men, because they were filled of the Holy Spirit, because they had wisdom, what do you think they have been doing until then? They've been preaching. They've been doing all kinds of work for God. But when the calling came, and maybe some of them thought, hey, I've been preaching on the streets and I see people healed, but now I have to leave all this and go give out bread, do something that's beneath me. No, they answered the call. And we're going to, like I said, we're going to stay. We're going to talk about Stephen next Sunday, how this guy preached the gospel. And one person who heard him preach the gospel was Paul. What difference in the history of Christianity? One person who committed himself, who answered the call, who answered the need made in this world because he was obedient to God. when we are serving God, we have to be ready for transfer in His kingdom. Because we never know when the call will come, when the need will arise. We'll have different tasks, but we receive the same training. We have the same spirit. We have the same authority in Christ. We have the same value before God. Because maybe you represent the front of the house, or maybe the kitchen. We're all doing the same work. We're doing the same work. We're installing the same culture in the kingdom of God. Now, let me ask you a question. Do you think God is limited by our own limitations? I wanted to show you some pictures. And again, this idea came to me as I was running. I tell you, this running gave me some ideas. As I was running, and I ran by an old, beat up, forgotten, poorly maintained church. And I was running by it. I thought to myself, I wonder how many lives have been changed in this building. I just thought about that. How many lives have been changed because they heard the gospel in this building? Maybe it's been 100 years ago, but someone heard the message of the gospel. And you know what happens to us? We look at this old, forgotten, beat up buildings, and we think, God, we'll never use them again. And then we look to big, wealthy, you know, well-maintained buildings, and we're thinking, of course, surely God can use that kind of building. They have everything going for them. They have the team. They have the staff. They have the money to do things. But let me tell you this. I already told you this long time ago, but let me remind you. The first church building was built in 312. In 312 AD. Up until then, church was meeting at homes. Building will not stop the kingdom of God from spreading. It's good to have building, and we're so blessed. When I talk to pastors, they say it's unheard of to launch the church in your own building. Of course, we lease this building, but we don't have to tear down anything. We don't have to set up and tear down. Let me show you next slide. Look at these faces. There is a baby. There's an old man. There is young people. Is there a doubt in your mind that God can use these people? You would say, if God has chosen this person or that person or that person, God could surely use them, right? God could use them. Maybe they don't have sufficient education. Maybe they don't have enough funds. Whatever else is going on in their life, it would not stop God from calling them. Remember Paul? He was in the opposite side of the church. He was persecuting. He was actually destroying the church. And then God says, hey, I want you on my team. You're so zealous. You're so full of passion. I want you on my team. No one can stop God. Grace, if you would come, please. Let me show you next slide, though. This is where it's going to happen for you. Do you think God would be stopped by any of your limitations? This is Faces of Connect Church. Different faces, different ages, different background, different upbringing, even different cultures. But do you think for a moment it would stop God from using you? Let me just tell you, you've been chosen to serve. You've been chosen to represent the kingdom of God. You've been chosen to represent the King of Kings. And no matter what your limitations are today, the power of God is sufficient enough to raise you up. To raise you up and to take you places where you've never been. Do you think when I was growing up, I envisioned pastoring church in Springfield, Missouri, who would, predominant majority of whom would speak a language that I did not know back then, or maybe go through situations and circumstances in life that are not familiar to me. God will not be stopped by your own limitations. But the need is there. But the need is there. So what happens? Numbers create needs, but needs create opportunity. And every met need create numbers. Here's what happened in verse 7. Let me just insert this word. Then the number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly because the need was met. Someone stepped up and served, giving their all. And a large number of priests, people who were in absolute opposite spectrum of the view who Jesus was, became obedient to the faith. They became obedient because someone stepped up, filled the gap. You've been chosen to serve. Today is first Sunday of the month. You know what it means? It means today is Connect Group Sunday. Connect Group Sunday. I know that we can recruit people left and right to lead or host Connect Groups, but I want to leave that task today to the Holy Spirit. I'm just going to give a call. I'm going to give you a shout out. I'm presenting you a need that as we grow in numbers, we need more Connect Groups in this church. Because I understand unless we meet the needs of people who are coming here, we cannot serve them. They will not stay. And I don't want them to stay for numbers. But I deeply understand that if God's sending us people, it's our job to serve them. God will send us number of people that we can serve. As soon as we lose our ability or willingness to serve people, God will stop sending us more people. It's God's people, but we have been called to serve. Let's answer God's call and start serving. Maybe when you don't think you're comfortable, maybe it's beneath your qualification or your experience, but if you answer the call of God, lives will be changed. Someone's faith will be encouraged and strengthened. You don't know what kind of impact you will have on their future and future of their children and their children's children and the community. The change begins with one act of obedience to God. The Bible says Jesus was obedient to death. That's why God exalted him. Let's worry about what our reward will be. Let's stay obedient today. God, you gave me salvation. You gave me everything I need. I want to do my part. I want to be obedient to you. And you've been chosen to spread the gospel, to bring the change in the lives of people. And we have a need, but it creates opportunity. And every met need creates numbers. I want us to bow our heads today. And let me speak to you for just a moment. As I was speaking to you, if you heard from the Holy Spirit, and God is prompting you to step up, to step out in faith and say, God, I have received so much of your grace. I have received so much of your forgiveness and power and mercies. I received everything, Lord. I am willing. Maybe I don't feel qualified already, but I'm willing to say, Lord, use me. Lord, use me in whatever capacity you want. If you are willing to step out and start serving, whatever capacity, whatever the needs is today, it's your opportunity to grab hold of it. You don't know what God has been preparing you for throughout the years of experience and your commitment to Christ. You don't know what happened, what God has been preparing you. But I tell you, journey with God is exciting. Journey with God is exciting. So if you are willing to serve, if you are willing to say, God, use me, I am willing to do whatever you call me to do. I want you to raise your hand right now if God has been calling you to serve, whatever it is, if God is calling you to serve. Thank you for your hand. Thank you for your hand. I want us to pray right now. Why don't we all stand up? And let's just pray. And those of you who may be still questioning your salvation, maybe you think, do I have a relationship with God? Does God know my name? If I met him on the street, would I know it's Jesus? And if he met me, would he know my name? if you're not sure about your personal relationship, if you never laid the burden of your sins and your guilt and your thoughts are just crushing you down, if you never laid it on Jesus and received forgiveness and freedom and absolute assurance of eternal life with Christ, I want you to be proactive today. I want you to make a step of faith. As we go into prayer and we go to worship, I will ask our prayer partners to go back to our prayer station. Right in the back, we have two prayer stations. And I want you to make your way there and say, hey, pray for me. I know God is calling me. And I've been just slow to respond. Today's the day when you say, God, I'm stepping out. I know I've been called. I've been chosen to serve. And you've been equipping me all these years. And today I'm going to say, Lord, I am ready. I want to serve. I want to commit myself to whatever you're calling me to. I want you to make that step. Be bold. Be courageous. Don't be afraid. So let us go into prayer right now, church. And I believe God is calling you out today. Don't hesitate. Be responsive. Be quick to respond and say, God, it's me. It's me. I'm coming. I am running. I want to answer the call. I want to be obedient. Father God, thank you so much. Thank you so much for Jesus. Thank you so much for Jesus. There was no reservation. There was no reservation on your part, Lord. You gave it all. You didn't leave anything. You gave everything. You said it is finished. And then you literally died on our behalf. Jesus, we receive this with such gratefulness. But there is no way we can ever repay you, Lord. So all you're asking us to serve, we've been chosen to serve. Lord, we take this with gratitude. We take this need as an opportunity for us to make the difference in this world, to make the change in the lives of people who are sending our way. Lord, we are here to embrace them, to love on them, Lord. And we're stepping out. We're accepting the challenge, Lord. And I pray for those people that you spoke to today, Lord. I pray that you encourage them, that you embolden them, Lord, to take that next step and transitioning from an idea, from revelation to reality, to commitment, to a step of faith. And when we step up, you show up in mighty power and things begin to happen. Lord, we just worship you today. Lord, and I pray your blessing over every person who may be still in question. They're not sure if they're saved. Maybe they know about you, but they can't say that they're your friend. Lord, I pray that you just talk to them today, Lord. I pray that it will be bold and courageous to say, I need Jesus. I need Jesus. And right now, if you are that person, would you raise your hand? We want to pray for you. If you are that person who want to say, I don't know if I'm 100% following Jesus. I don't know if Jesus is my Savior. I don't know if I die today that I can spend eternity with Him. I want you to be bold. I don't want you to be wasting your time, because the time with Jesus is a new time. It's a new time, and it's time that will take you through eternity. Like I said, as we go into worship, I want you to make your way to our prayer partners in the back and just be bold, be courageous. Don't hesitate, because if God is calling you, just answer. Be bold.